I spoke to you about the basics of GIS. What about the concept of spatial data? We saw two different data models. And then I gave you the basic operations which are available under the raster data structure. Now let us try to look at some of the algorithms or functionality they are available under the vector data structure. So in vector, what we saw, we can have layers, and the way the data gets stored in a way, vector data model, is in terms of point, line, area, etc. So when you want to work out any analysis in vector using multiple layer, the one of the simplest available query for vector data is, it is very strong in the attribute database, because you know any point or line, everything automatically, a database gets created where you can add the attributes. So simplest as far as the vector is concerned, non-spatial query. And the thing is, non-spatial query is one of the easiest analysis methods and maximum used in a GIS. See, if you have come across the different GIS packages, people might have used, people who are working in GIS for maybe, you know, for about a decade. Map info had been a very powerful package. Similarly, from ESRI, they came out a tool called ArcView. The success for them and all, the basically the query through database. Because many planners, many, you know, decision makers, they may not do any high-end analysis. They would like to see the spatial data in the context of non-spatial data. So non-spatial data query becomes the easiest, where, you know, you try to use the attribute table query, like, you know, show me the villages which have no school, or show me the villages which have, you know, school going children more than 500 and no school. If your tables are properly organized for the features, then non-spatial query runs in an easy way. And always non-spatial query means a single layer with the attributes. Because, you know, of course, when you have a very powerful analysis in the vector, it will run spatial objects with non-spatial query. Here what I'm showing is just the non-spatial query in a single layer. Like, you know, you suppose you have the data for any one of the tehsils with block boundary. You just say show the distribution of villages which have infrastructure facilities, like which have post offices, which have no facility, which has post offices with bus stop, banks. Like that, if you put a query, system can immediately generate the thematic map and give to the user. Here you do not need any high-end analysis or modeling or anything. With simple query on the tabular database, the map can be generated. Why the map gets generated? The reason is, there is already a link between the ID of the spatial objects with the record in the tabular data. If you have touched that ID, your results will go wrong. So, you know, the link between your point objects and the current record must be correct. Then only if I select for a data for Mumbai, it should show me the Mumbai polygon and not, you know, Pune polygon. The link should not be broken. That one has to keep in mind. If the links are proper, the system will generate it. That is a simple non-spatial data query. Now, coming to the spatial query, broadly you can categorize as far as the vector analysis is concerned, something which can run on two layers, some queries which can run on single layer. Okay? In two layers, I'm not going to cover you entire detail of each and every functionality. Just to summarize, same like what we saw in raster. We saw overlay, we saw conditional table, we saw map algebra. Same way here, you have the functions like union, intersect, identity, XR, clip, update, array, split. These are some of the common functionality available in any GIS tool, which is a vector-based tool. So union means, it is the same what we see in the set theory of union. A union B means what? It will create a new set which will have all the elements of A and all the elements of B. Same concept is done here. So when you say union, it is A union B set theory you take back. Intersect, A intersection B, which are common to both. In fact, if you talk in a Boolean concept, A union B is Boolean R, A intersect B is Boolean AND. So both must be true. And A union B is, either of them can be true. So Boolean R is equal to union, and Boolean AND is equal to intersect. So suppose you look at it, so when, see, operations are performed between two layers to get the relationship between them. Again, the emphasis same like raster. When I said in raster, whenever you run an analysis, please see that all your layers are of the same size. You do a pre-processing and bring the data set so that every layer should have the same rows and columns, same projection, same resolution. Same thing is here. Whenever, as long as these layers share a common coordinate system, they can be related together. So one should see that it is done so that one layer sits exactly over the other layer. Okay, whenever a new layer is formed, again the concept is same like an overlay in raster. It combines the layers, creates a table for whatever the combination occurs. So whenever you take an overlay, one is point can overlay with polygon, line can overlay with polygon, polygon layer can overlay with polygon. So when do we run point with polygon? Suppose I take India ka data. Somebody gives me all the locations of hospitals of India. And you have administrative boundary map separately. You have taken from somebody showing all the tehsil boundaries for every state. You can combine both of them with point in polygon. You will result what? You will result in a point layer. See, you have a point layer, you have a polygon layer. This contains the locations of hospitals. This gives you the administrative boundaries, let us say at the block or tehsil level. When you run point in polygon, you will result in a point layer, but it will have one more attribute showing in which polygon, in which village I am sitting or in which tehsil I am sitting. So that is the advantage of point with polygon. Same way, you can do line with polygon. You have the road network map. You put it with your state boundaries. Let us say all the national highways network. You combine it with the polygon layers of states. Immediately you will result in a line layer only, a road layer only. But the road layer will break wherever it meets the state boundary. And the new roads will create a table showing I am in this state. It will have one more attribute whether that part is in Maharashtra or Karnataka or Gujarat. Okay, that is the advantage of line with polygon. And when you run with polygon, we use the word union. Okay, polygon with polygon, it is same like a set union. So you result in a new map which contains the polygon boundaries of both the layers and a new table gets created. Suppose a soil one corner gets intersected with the part of a slope one, you will have a new polygon and it will have a new ID which gets concatenated from soil one and slope. So the table will guide you along with the map how to proceed. Okay, union is a very common operation whenever you have to combine more layers. Okay, so union is very commonly used. As I said, it is a Boolean OR operation. And contrast to it, when you want to run, okay, this is an example which you can see. I said, you know, when you have a polygon layer, another polygon layer, system will overlay it, system will create you the table. It will do everything and give you the result. But you know, the complexity, what the system works, one should know. It is an example which I got from, you know, one of the public domain tools, where they have taken only two polygons. One polygon is in one layer, another polygon is in another layer, they have overlaid. You see, A is a polygon, B is a polygon. When it is combined, you see how many new polygons are formed. If you look at this diagram, you will see there are 9 polygons. One which contains both A and B, 4 which contain only A and without B, four which are only B without A. So whenever you try to run a union operation, the complexity increases. But since they also create a default table guiding you, it becomes easy. Okay, so many polygons are there as per your criteria. What are their area? Everything, area, perimeter, everything gets stored automatically. So system can use it. Okay, so this is union, which is, this is an example of again a union operation where you have one map, another map, when you combine it, you get an overlaid map. And the corresponding table also gets created. Now, we saw Boolean OR. Now comes Boolean AND, which is an intersect. So intersect, when can we use? Because you know, when both are common, you have to use it. Suppose you have a soil map, you have a slope map, you are interested in the polygons which have a specific soil category and a specific slope category. So it looks those polygons, picks up and creates a new layer. Okay? So intersect is contrast to A union B, the area which are common to both gets intersected and stored. Of course, intersect can be run in many ways. See, you can again, you know, you have a point layer. I say I have the locations of hospitals for the entire country. You want only to pick up for your state. So put that polygon alone. It will crop it out and give you a layer, giving those point positions only for that polygon. So I'm interested in the hospitals only in Maharashtra state. I just intersect with that polygon. It will pick out and give. Whether it's a row layer or point layer or a polygon layer, based on the intersecting layer, it will crop out and take it out. Okay? And another is a clip operation. Of course, symmetric difference is there. I said update is there. There are a number of operations. Only few of them I'm just showing. Clipping is something. You want to clip out only what you wanted. You have take a map, land use map of the entire country. You want to clip out only for your study area. You can simply put it. It can clip out and take it. Okay? So it's like windowing what we do in image processing. Same way, one can just clip out the area. That is also possible. And you know, some area you want to mask. You have the total map. Due to security reason or something, you want to mask the data. Simply put that polygon and run the mask operation. In your thematic map, the data will be masked. So mask is again a useful operation in vector. And then update. So updation is our regular thing. As I said, you know, unless information is up to date, nobody will use it. So if you have an old land use map or an old road network map, you want to add the new road layers in it, take the new road layers alone, ask the old map to update it, it will add all the new segments to it and give you an updated layer. So input can be a point layer or a line layer or a polygon layer. Accordingly, you can create an updated layer. And another is split. These are all what I am covering is what? Two layers operation in vector GIS. Okay? So split is something. Again, an example of, I'll take our country. You have the entire road network of this country. You are taken from some department. And you want for every state separate. What way you have to do? Maybe, you know, for 27 times you have to clip it out. Put this boundary, clip it, this boundary, clip it. Split is a command where if you have the road network and I have all the state boundaries, I run a clip operation. For every state, it will split it and save as many layers. So, you know, instead of doing one clip, multi-clip operation is done. And how many input polygons are there in your second layer, that many layers get created automatically. So, you know, somebody was asking, why, you know, how do they store the region data? How do they store, you know, multi-point data and all? All these functions, although they started generating when an application demanded. See, any technology gets evolved or grown. So, you know, basic commands they would have put. Maybe union intersect. And somebody says, okay, I want to run this application. When the developer thinks, okay, this is a functionality which is not available in the tool, I may have to add it. That is the way, you know, more and more functionality had been added, both in the raster domain as well as in the vector domain. Split is also a very useful tool when we try to work for the multi-polygon area. So these are some of the double layers operations. Now coming to single layer, we saw there, like, you know what, we saw buffering. I told you about proximity, I told you about the distance. The functions which are available in vector domain, they have developed those operations based on what is happening in a two layer operation. See, whenever you try to take a two layer operation, I have one with 3-4 polygons, another with 3-4 polygons I combine. I may have n number of polygons. And what happens, there may be small polygons which may not contribute anything for you. It may be due to even poor digitization. It may happen. So they have given commands which helps you to merge the nearby polygons and dissolve the boundary. Okay, see, it operates on a single layer, merges the selected polygons with the neighboring polygons that have the largest shared border between them and that have the largest area. So whenever you try to run a union operation, normally we say it creates unwanted polygons, which we call as sliver. Thin, skinny, long polygons get created, which we term it as sliver polygons. These sliver polygons can be removed by using the eliminate operation. Normally they ask you a threshold value, that they say how much area the polygon should cover which can be eliminated. You give that threshold value, any polygon which has the area less than your threshold value, they get eliminated. Okay, so eliminate is a command. And another thing is dissolve is like eliminate, but what it doesn't eliminate it. Suppose when you overlay, you come across two polygons, the new ID generated, let us say soil 1, slope 1, is same for this polygon and the nearby polygon. Let us say two adjacent polygons are with the same ID. Then why should you have two polygons? Common boundary can be removed. So dissolve is something based on if the two polygons have the same user ID, common area gets erased and it becomes a single polygon. Okay? And of course buffer. Same like what we saw in vector. Whether you have a road layer or a point layer or a polygon layer, buffering is one of the useful commands as far as the spatial planning is concerned, very commonly used. So whenever you have a layer, you can give the buffering distance so that the buffering can be immediately created. And the buffering can be like, you know, suppose you have a road, you want only one side buffer, other side maybe the city, you want to protect only other side. System can create both the sides buffer, only one side buffer. When you have a polygon like a city, you can create only an internal buffer, you can create an external, you can create both the buffers. Giving a selected distance, buffers can be created. So all these options are normally available in a vector. So raster gives a lot of functionality, vector supports a lot of functionality. This is an example where, you know, on a land use, a raster buffer is drawn along the water body to see what kind of land use is covered by those buffering near the water body. Okay, so we saw some of the vector operations, some of the raster operations, and one more analysis which comes in a GIS is network analysis. Network analysis runs on a vector model, and the usefulness is for transportation. So whether you want to find the shortest path, whether you want to find an optimal path, this can be used. Okay, you give a source and destination, you have a network connectivity, properly that network should be formed. If there is a gap, you will have a break. If the network is properly connected, then one can run it for shortest path, especially for routing, and also for location allocation analysis. You have all the demand nodes, you have the supply nodes, like, you know, you are a factory where you have a go downs are there, warehouses are there, you have to pick up and distribute the commodity, or you are doing a distribution like a fair price shop distribution. All these things can be done when you have a source and node properly, it can be distributed. So the thing is, for giving the demand node and supply node, how the vehicle should go, that network it decides optimally. So location allocation is one of the applications which can be done in network. Of course, there are more applications. I have not given you the view graphs, like service area. Given a location, like I say, a bank or an hospital or a school, you say it covers an area around 1 kilometer. It can provide the service around 1 kilometer around it. So what area it can cover, it can show. Will it be a circle? When I say this location will cover 1 kilometer around it, it won't be a circle, because as I said, in network we don't work on crow fly distance, we don't work on Euclidean distance, we work on actual road network. So every direction it will take the road network which covers around 1 kilometer distance, it will link it and create you an irregular polygon. It will not be sphere, it is not radial. Okay, so service area also, it's in fact service area is a simple application which is widely used in a GIS and a network. Technically simple, there is no shortest path finding, nothing. It only calculates the distance and connects, but very useful as far as the user is concerned. Okay, so that is as far as the analysis is concerned. Then comes the visualization of the data. GIS gives you enormous facilities to visualize any software tool, whether you want as a map, whether you want as a table, whether you want to look at only as a database, you want to only temporarily use as a query. All facilities are available. People can pan the image, visualize, and as such that fly through is possible. One can, you know, change the scale, projection the way you want to do it. So, you know, a lot of options are available as far as the visualization is concerned. These are some of the examples which I am showing from Gram++. It is a map where a simple map is shown with the house network in one of the slums in Bhopal. And you know, facilities are normally provided for zooming. It can even, any part moment you are visualizing, system helps you to zoom it. You can have a 3D visualization where the terrain can be put virtually over the topography and one can visualize it. And another thing is, it can help you in hierarchical map view. Suppose you have the area for the entire state, you have the data. For in the state, you have for every district. And in the district, you have for every tehsil. In the tehsil, you have for every village. You can open, click, click, click. If they are properly linked at any hierarchical level, you can open it, query it, get the result. So hierarchical viewing also is possible in a GIS. And before closing, I want to tell, see, one main issue as far as GIS is, it's a very powerful tool. It can do many things. Applications are very many. But what we all should keep in mind is accuracy. If you are wrong, results will go wrong. Don't think it is a god, it will do nothing. If we are wrong, if our data is corrupted, if our data is poor quality, you will not get proper result. That people, whoever doing for whatever the application, accuracy is very, very important. A lot of research is going on globally only on GIS accuracy, uncertainty, etc. Data quality, because you know, if I approach a raster model, I'll get one result. If I get a vector model, I'll get another result. If my grid size changes, I may get another result. See, everything changes because, you know, it is sensitive. If I change a weight, you do some multi-layer analysis. Let's say crop suitability. You may give one set of weights, I may give another set of weights. Your location for reservoir will be different my location. So, you know, accuracy is very, very important. Right from the sources, data sources, who had done it, what has been the method he had used, what satellite data he had used to prepare that map. One has to know. See, today a lot are spoken in GIS community about metadata, data about data. So the data sources you should know, what way they have analyzed the data, you have to know when you depend on secondary sources. If you are doing your own primary survey, you add the information in your data. I bought this data on such and such a data and such a method. I used to prepare that map so that for another user it will be useful. So always information should be well done. And you know, a lot of research is going on. Conference proceedings are there. Books are available on errors in GIS. So entire our results will depend on what we have input. So you know, your position there, I used to joke in my class. I said, if I say I will find a location for school, instead of in Mumbai city, I may be sitting in Arabian Sea. Ho sakta hai, because my data is bad. You are not wrong in your analysis or in your GIS tool. So you know, one has to be very careful, and any application you take, please see whether your scale suits your application. What I do for a city, what I do for a district, what I do for a campus, they are all different. The scale should be good. Whether you have all data relevant for your application did you get, or there are information gaps, based on all your results will come. GIS can do wonders provided we take care of all these things. Okay? And so if you have all the concepts, what we call spatial modeling is, it is the process of manipulating, analyzing spatial data, generate useful information for solving complex problems. General definition on spatial modeling. How do you do? Whenever you take it, identify a problem. Break down the problem. Simply you have to put it in such a level, you should come to the atomic level what you want to do. You have the data, what method you are going to use, will your GIS support it? You have to draw, break it and bring it to a full flowchart. then only unless you develop clear and logical flow, you cannot do the successfully the use the tool. If you do everything, run the model, modify if it is necessary, you will get the results. So one has to keep in mind, applications are many, many. There is no area where GIS cannot be used. Maybe, you know, you may think that I am working on GIS, I am trying to promote. That's not the case. Every day we come across new applications in GIS, and just listing a few of them. And as per last year survey, it is not even 2007 survey, 2006 newsletter when I got, they said annually it is a $12 billion industry in terms of what? Data. There are people who provide data and charge. Because as I said, information is power. It can be bought and sold for money. So data, software, services, people provide services, data conversion services, web services, etc. Publications, training. So it's around a $12 billion industry. Every day the technology is growing, applications are growing. And if you want to classify overall the GIS, you can have a high end. Because, you know, someone asked me after my first lecture, how do you compare ArcGIS with other tools? See, everything has a goal, objective, the way it can work. There are tools which are available for crores of rupees. There are tools available which are for thousands of rupees. So what we look, what we can afford, what application I am going to do, accordingly one has to spend money. A great government department can pour crores of rupees. A small college may not be able to do that. So, you know, we have to look at all these things. There are enterprise GIS available, there are desktop GIS tools available. Just, you know, you can have a palm top or a PDA, GIS runs today. There are GIS, I told you when I spoke about components, that, you know, modeling. Today, libraries are available, components are available in GIS. You buy the components, you customize your full application with your own programming so that the components will sit like a back. And you, the whole SGSS will look like your own tool. Components are available. Simple viewers are available like MapInfo or ArcView, where you don't need a high-end things. And then web-based GIS. Web-based GIS, somebody spends money to load the server and keep the GIS and keep the data. We people as a user go to the browser, query it and get the result. We don't spend any pie. Somebody maintains, he has to spend. He has to spend for server. Get the data, GIS, map server, everything he had to spend. We as a user, simply we sit in our lab and we try to query it and get the result. Okay? So software are all can be classified in different categories. So to conclude, I tell if you have a clear objectives, proper orientation, time scale, what you want to communicate to the user as a result, if things are all there, the management of GIS will meet a success. So understanding GIS requires science, systems and studies. We know that, you know, GIS provides a framework to manage today's world. The real value of GIS is in its problem solving capability. It's growing, its future is also growing. Especially in our country, there are a lot of, you know, untapped applications, requirements, etc. Is that very high in GIS. If you learn properly, put properly, promote properly, it can meet success. Okay. Thank you. Yes.
What about the networking problem that you have discussed? Will it be possible to have some diversion in between and check or suggest that some alternative route can be adopted?
Absolutely. Absolutely possible. 100% possible. You can put the road where there is a construction work going on, where you have a traffic jam, where you have a hindrance. All these things you can give as an impedance value so that system will show you the alternate route. Okay, that is why I say it is not a shortest path, it is an optimal path. Okay, network gives a lot of capabilities. And even when one network it has done, if you say you give me a second alternative, system can give. That is possible.
Some missing data is there. Can we do any analysis on that using GIS?
Missing data is there means, see, suppose I'll tell you, if you are using an interpolation, you can get the missing data. That's one of the methods. You can use trend analysis to get missing data. But, you know, the results will not be better than what you have input. See, I have a 450 contour and 470 contour. In between, you will assume it is linearly growing. In between, there is a valley. System will not know. Followed, na?
So that analysis should be done separately.
Yeah, see, that is one thing. Another, when we say on error evaluation, I normally try to talk, because I'm not covering a lecture on error out here. See, normally sensitivity analysis is a must today in GIS. Any paper you see, they'll write sensitivity analysis, because see, I put a weight. To me, as my expertise, that looks correct. If I go and sit to next colleague, he may say this weight is wrong, I'll put another weight. Your result changes. So what they do, whenever you try to do a multi-layer method with putting any criteria, you get a boundary, a range of min-max weight. And if I give minimum, what is your output? When you give maximum, what's your output? So that your result can be within a range, not point location. Okay? So that's the way they do. So missing data can be done only as of today by interpolation and using trend analysis, etc. If major parameter is missing, you have to change your flow. Because, you know, nothing can gap it. See, I saw some student or, you know, some department person who came. He wanted to work on water resources. He brought a big area. Rainfall station, AKA. So he says rainfall is very important. For poor rainfall, AKA, AKA map. I said, then that layer is not going to play a role. Because you have only one station. So you assume, you know, everywhere rainfall, what is that it is going to do? So you don't need to use that layer at all. No doubt rainfall is important, but with single value you cannot do anything. So this we have to think and take care of whenever we do the analysis. Okay.